بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يمكن قبل ما أقول كلماتي وهي مكتوبة
Before I present my paper which is written I just wanted to comment on the realization part about implementing ethics on reality and the most dangerous thing in this issue is what I have called for before the Arab revolutions and the Egyptian revolution which is the separation from tasks and the political work because when the ethics are throughout the Islamic history if ethics are separated from the politics that's a big issue so if our scholars become the execution for the politics who will prevent who will protect the ethics and there are many people unfortunately and many Islamic parties that something did not do they were not able to protect the ethics and some may disagree with me and there's an incident in Egypt that some of those who are in charge of the propagation tasks are the ones also who practicing the party task with all its mistakes, with us all its shortcomings. And this is something natural. And some young people in Egypt, which is unfortunate sometimes, they are still reconsidering, is this the Islam that we are proud of? Are these the prominent scholars that we use to take as role model? Yes, Dr. Salah said, now we are experiencing a new experience with Islamic party. Yes, they lack experience and they face many problems and many issues. But I still insist, and I have mentioned, I hear call for the Islamic parties and movements as institutions and as societies to remain or maintain their propagation tasks, whether Al-Azhar or even the Muslim Brotherhoods or the Salafists, they need to remain them. They want them to remain their tasks of propagation. And we see that one of the reasons behind the collapse of our economy and politics is the absence of ethics. We don't have in the Arab world or in the Islamic world only, but even in the West, when what America practice against Muslims, as Dr. Salah mentioned, and what has Islam also practiced against Muslims, this shows the lack so and prove the lack of ethics and the lack of justice because also in this community the guards of ethics also were absent and if the ethics were not based on a doctrine and a spiritual condition it will be useless like any, or it will be manipulated like other things human rights came from the West aren't they themselves who killed a million Iraqi and they make 4 million Iraqis homeless and they are the ones themselves who are silent on the killing and of the Muslims and transferring Gaza to a big prison where are human rights now where are ethics and the scholars and the intellectuals, Muslims or non-Muslims or even the Jews, they need to play their religious role to protect the ethics. Otherwise, the world will become a forest or become so to we need to separate politics tasks from propagation tasks. Those who do the propagation should
والعلماء والدعاء في ناحية ليس في ناحية من حيث الممارسة ولا الأفكار ولا السلوك.
These need to be two different tasks.
ومفاهيم واحدة سواء كان السياسي أو الداعية أو الطبيب أو المهندس. دي نقطة بين يدي الحديث عن
just a point, because until now we still recall from history and from the behavior of Prophet Muhammad and his companions and his caliphates those great values. Where are they on the ground now in our countries as Arabs and Muslims now? That's what we are afraid for in the future, that if those propagative Islamic movements, if they apply their partisanship and politics, then that will be a threat to the country. I go back to my presentation quickly. If ethics are the best way to deal with human being as an independent creature, then politics is the best way to deal with society as individuals gathered. So there's a surprise now between separating the two until it became that there's no politics in ethics, no ethics in politics, even though both move in the same direction in service for humanity, which is nourishment and taking care of mankind. So of course they do have their own schemes, but they interact in an interactive scheme. If politics is the way to lead the group of humanity and manage their affairs for their good and to benefit them, then ethics is the values that will direct the human beings toward what is believed that is good and beneficial, and to avoid what is evil. And they, both politics and ethics, target to give people a vision that makes their life of a goal and of a meaning and of a value. Nothing connected to mankind intellectually without an ethical weight. This is the way that man should move. If some experiments show that ethics may not be profitable in terms of the general sense of the word, and we could imagine many perspectives where lying and oppression are the beneficial, and the Prophet also has led some to say that policy should behave always as if human beings were always evil villains, and that power is beneficial for the success of the political projects. But all that still as undermining mankind and depriving them from happiness. We all know that religion comes before ethics, and in principle no ethics without religion. There are human ethics, but they are deprived of the human depth of feeling it and imagining it in terms of eternity. That is what is needed for mankind to overcome the utilitarianism and to combat what is in the West secularism, which separates and isolates ethics from politics. So this independence and isolation between two has harmed mankind. Voltaire said that when he spoke about sacrifice, sacrifice is from a special personal interest. So they say that ethics does not bring about right, but right is what brings about ethics, and that's true and historically true. If evil and goodness are ethics, and a policy, then saying that policy has ethics dictates a comprehensive system where the good ethics are the component and basis. The most important question now is about true link and realistic link between political virtues and ethical virtues, as they all belong to the same set of principles, if we can say, and they meet in one system. So the wisest is the best leader, and the best state is the one that can combine politics with ethics. Therefore, we can overcome this dichotomy if we look at the link between one and the other, and to stop understanding that one is controlling the other, but both belong to one common system that includes them both and integrates them both. That is, the solution will not be with the politicians, but rather between through the combining of both politics and ethics. The first article in each policy at any time, any place, is freedom that is linked properly to the other freedoms. And each political system should face the requirement, which is freedom for mankind, and the regime will not be settled unless they satisfy this need. Violating human rights is the first step to killing their morality and ethics, and to deprive them of all the good values and spreading the culture of selfishness. Contrary to that, when there is a social contract based on politics of justice and freedom, that would be the best environment to build a good relationship between politics and ethics that guarantee that they both resort to a common system that includes them both and maybe passes them over and takes them to uplift them. Keeping power in order to serve a political group at the cost and price of the people will bring about oppression, that my policy is the best, and then the lies come about. And ethically, they start redefining each thing, where each opposition to this or that regime will be an absolute evil that doesn't even exist to live. Despotism does away with all the best ethics and values so that it protects its own interests, where it tries to spread about the culture of submissiveness and make people timid to face those unjust procedures through punishment and retribution, where the human dignity becomes difficult to come about. Al-Kawakibi, for more than 100 years, said in a text that is still vivid till now, that despotism controls the good ethics and distorts them and turns upside down the good ethics, where the one who seeks the truth is an oppressor and the one who complains as a corrupt, and the one that is passive is a good one, and thus becomes everybody who is generous as a hypocrite. So the words really change, and every good meaning of good words become the exact opposite of it, and that helps the villains to do whatever they want, secured that they will not be faced with any punishment. Indeed, politics in the past was a meaning of leadership and guiding people. So we find that most the understandings in the past carried on meanings that are close to ethics and reform in society than modern-day politics, which is based on the self-interest of the individual or the party or the state, which shows to the ethical foundation of our civilization in terms of the political behavior, how it was understood and applied. In conclusion, ethics are the topics of all religions, Islam, the last of which has come to complement the best of ethics, and religion is the best ethics. The most religious is the most ethical, and vice versa. Ethics based on the brain and the mind will deprive them of their truthness, and because ethics are stemmed from religion. Also, the contradiction between ethics and religion is imaginary, and that is due to greed, as some say. The culture of each person is that to exploit others, but Islam, and the Prophet says, nobody among you will be a believer unless he believes or wishes for himself what he wishes for the others. So therefore, people should not exploit one another, but they should rely upon each other. The West failed in terms of confining the limits between freedom and politics, so the human behavior has really reached the point of let everyone do whatever he or she wants as long as they don't harm others. And that's a very negative and bad understanding. Separating that which is political and ethical will not only lead to violence, but to undermine the foundation of the human society. Algerian intellectual Malik bin Nabi said, if science is a way of conscience, then politics between separating politics and ethics would also be a destruction for humanity. Others have said similar things that point that there should be no separation between politics and ethics. And really, if you want to guard freedom, then you should rely on the people and not the rulers and the politicians. Secularism mentioned by our beloved doctor, its reputation is bad in the Arab world because it is still requires to be enemy against religion, even though somebody resolved this dichotomy to say that comprehensive and complete secularism such as the one practiced in Turkey, but the AKP has been able to overcome this problem where it instilled the idea that secularism is not contradictory to religion and it helps society and the individual. Is there an alternative to separate ethics from politics in the Arab world? That's not an alternative. I speak about Egypt. Egypt, the issue of religion in Egypt is also widespread in Egypt, and that's what makes us in our Egypt, strong Egypt party. Some people ask, are you a secular party or religious party? I say, we are an Egyptian party. Can somebody mention Egypt without imagining Al-Azhar Mosque or doesn't understand that Egypt has the values of Islamic cultures and the ethics of the great religion Islam. But what we did in our Strong Egypt Party is to abandon the slogans and to transform the values we believe into reality on the ground. Because the Islamic and Arab situation, one of its disasters is that it was mere slogans. The AKP, what they do in Turkey, what was their practice? When they looked into the needs of the people and solved the economic problems and the unemployment and upgraded the economy and education, isn't this where the best understanding of serving the people without slogans? In many times you find that the content and reality is contradictory to the slogans, because mankind is only an energy. If he spends it in slogans and shouting, then this energy will be away from the content. So superficial societies usually deal with slogans and they stay away from the substance, even though they both should go hand in hand. But if anything, we should care about the substance and not the slogans. The Islamic movements in the Arab world should revisit its ethics and cultures so that they become civil, not military. I don't mean civil versus religious. No, I mean civil versus military. Even though parties in Egypt all call for the values of Islam, whether they are liberal or whatever. You find a liberal person in a party will say, I just came back from Umrah or the small pilgrimage. So they should revisit their alphabets and their principles where they sometimes we find them that they obey blindly. It shouldn't be like that. All that could be okay in the military. Military should be like that. But when there is an Islamic civil institute or movement, they should revisit their culture and ethics, where they be civil, that allow dialogue and allow even the abandoning of this party without being considered a disbeliever or he or she is being tortured or jailed. Because in the army, when this happens, it's called subordination, not so in the political parties, or it should not be like that. In the past, Western colonization has dictated that all movements should militarize. In the times of the colonization era, we used to teach our kids to carry arms to face the colonizer. But why should we do the same thing right now? It's okay, you can teach kids that in the military, but to teach that militaristic approach in a civilian party, why should we do that? Islamic movements in the past did that, which was okay at some point in time, but now we should be civil parties, civil organizations. So what I'm speaking about is that they should revisit their principles and what they teach to their kids, because Egypt and the Arab world need those movements, because they are the ones who kept the heritage and culture of this country, provided that they repent to Allah or God and go back to their values, which on which they were built upon by the pioneer, which is Hassan al-Banna, who has established this movement. That doesn't mean that there should not be any competition or moving from this party to another party, but they should not be doing anything that violates this. Thank you.